Good morning, dear students. This is M. Komala Devi, KG BV Gangavaram, Chittoor District, AP. Students, today we are going to discuss about changing cultural traditions in Europe, 1300 to 1800. As all of us know that there are totally seven continents in the world. There are Asia, Africa, North America, South America, Antarctica, Europe, and Australia. See, you can see that all those continents in the map. You can recognize it also. Then, coming to the Europe is the second smallest continent in the world. Asia is the largest continent in the world, and Australia is the first smallest continent in the world. And Europe is pre-developed continent. These are the periods in the European history. Ancient period up to 400 AD. Medieval period 400 AD to 1300 AD. Early modern period 1300 to 1800 AD. Modern period 1800 to present. Now we are going to discuss about the early modern period, which is from 1300 AD to 1800 AD. The medieval world in the Europe. The domination of Europe by the Roman Empire. And here the great cities like Rome and Alexandria flourished during this period. The culture that had been developed in Greece and Rome are sculpture, painting, buildings, as well as literature, philosophy, and science was of a very high order. This is about the medieval world in the Europe. Declination of Roman Empire. After 400 AD, when the Roman Empire declined, there were no large empires in the Western Europe. The cities are also too hard, declined, and most people lived in the villages. And in those days, the trade was also very minimal. Europe came to be dominated by a social system called feudalism. So what is meant by feudalism? A feudal system, which is also known as feudalism, it is a type of social and political system in which landholders provide land to tenants in exchange for their loyalty and services, especially military service. The social system which existed in the Middle Ages in Europe, in which people worked and fought for the person who owned the land and received the land and protection from him in return. This is about the feudalism. Then feudalism powers. Under feudalism, the political power was with large warriors, landlords, who controlled the villages and peasants. Peasants means that a person who owns or rents a small piece of land and grows crops, keep animals on it, especially one who has a low income and very little education and a low social position. So that person is called as peasants. The peasants were mostly serfs who were bound to their lords and had to fill the lands of the lords and work in their worship and also fight for them in wars. Serfs means that peasants bound to their lords and had to till the land of the lords. They also had their own lands and sustained their families by working on them too. The lords were constantly at war with each other, and this created a lot of insecurities for the peasants. Cultural change in after 300 AD. The long distance trade between the European countries and China, Arabia, and India and Egypt was restored, and many new towns and cities were developed suddenly in the Europe where traders and artisans lived. Many of these cities were politically independent and ruled themselves through municipalities. Whereas coming to the Renaissance, The Renaissance is the term which is used to describe the period in European history marking the transition from the Middle Ages to modernity and covering the 15th and 16th centuries. It occurred after the crisis of the late Middle Ages and was associated with the great social change. From the 19th century, historians used the term Renaissance to describe the cultural changes of this period. Means, I repeat, Renaissance describe the cultural changes of this period. What are all the cultural changes after 300 BC? The situation began to change after 300 AD. The peasants had begun to resist and fight against the serfdom and control of the lords and the church. For example, there was a great revolt of the peasants in England in 1381, which ended the serfdom in England. The similar movements were taking place in other countries too. The control of the lords and the church over the people had begun to change and people enjoyed the freedom. Renaissance. People began to go beyond their limits set by the religious priests and raised the new questions and found new ways of answering to those questions, like new places, like about the science and about the paint and printing press, and new questions, sculpture, literature. So these are all the new ways of answering those type of questions. Renaissance. The traders and adventurers set out on long voyages, a long journey involving the travel by a sea or in space to find out the new routes and lands. Can anybody answer who founded the India by a sea route? I think almost of you aware of that question. Who founded the India by sea route? Vasco da Gama in the year 1497. And the next question is, who founded America? Many of you already might aware of this question. That is Christopher Columbus in the year 1492. New trends in art, painting, sculpture, and literature developed rapidly. And Jacob Burckhardt, we are going to discuss about this one. Historians used the term Renaissance to describe the cultural changes of this period. The historian who emphasized the most was a Swiss scholar, Jacob Burckhardt of Switzerland. So in the year 1860, he wrote a book called The Civilization of the Renaissance in Italy. This is also a very important point. He wrote a book called The Civilization of the Renaissance in Italy, in which he called the reader's attention to literature, architecture, and painting to describe how a new humanist culture had flowed in the Italian towns from the 14th to 17th century. Jacob Burckhardt wrote the culture was characterized by a new belief that man, as an individual, he was capable of making his own decisions and developing his skills. He was modern in contrast to medieval man whose thinking had been controlled by the church. The revival of the Italian cities. The revival of Italian cities. With the expansion of trade between Byzantine Empire and the Islamic countries, the ports on the Italian coast developed. From the 12th century, as the Mongols opened up the trade with the China and as trade with the Western Europe countries also increased, Italian towns played a central role. They no longer saw themselves as a part of a powerful empire, but as independent city-states. Two of these, Florence and Venice, were republics, and many other were court cities ruled by the princes. The revival of Italian cities. Two of the vibrant cities were Venice and Genoa. These cities were different from other parts of Europe. The clergy, member of the church, priests and bishops and cardinals and pope were the not politically dominant here, and nor they were the powerful feudal lords. The rich merchants and bankers actively participated in the governing the city, and this helped the idea of citizenship to strike the root. And humanism and universities. The literature of ancient Greeks had reflected an interest in the life. They had been vitally interested in the world in which they lived. The students of ancient Greek literature, which dealt with the nature and interest of man, were called as humanists. The students of the ancient Greek literature, which dealt with the nature and interest of man, were called as humanists. Students, this is also a very important point. They became interested in this world rather than in a future life as the scholars of the Middle Age had been. Everything in nature, science, and the arts that affected the man was important to the humanist. Humanism started in Italy, but very soon spread into the France, England, and the Netherlands. Universities were established to teach a new subject, law and religions. Educated men became so much of interested. One of the greatest of these was the Dutchman Erasmus. He studied earnestly the New Testament in the original Greek and the writings of the early Greek Christians. He criticized some of the beliefs of the church, which he said were based on superstition, in his book Praise of Folly. The humanist ideas extended to art and architecture. In the sphere of visual art, like painting and sculpture, took the form of realism. Artists observed the nature, the people, and the places around them and sought to represent them as they were. This was very difficult from the spirit of the religious art promoted by the church in the feudal times. Artist and realism. The religious art emphasized by the religious themes and depicting the people and the things according to some ideal forms. Art was supposed to represent those ideas and not the reality around them. Artists of Renaissance began to portray themes from around them, from Greek and Roman literature, which showed the feelings and power and strength of human beings. One implication of this trend was to study the real world of nature and human beings. Artists also began to study the remains of Roman culture and their buildings, culture, etc. Their admiration for the figures of perfectly proportioned men and women sculpted so many centuries ago made Italian sculptors want to continue their tradition. In the year 1940, Donatello broke a new ground with his lifelike statues. Artist concern to be accurate was helped by the work of scientists. To study bone structure, artists went to the laboratories of medical schools. Andrea Vesalis, a Belgian and a professor of medicine at the University of Padua, was the first to dissect the human body. This was the beginning of the modern physiology. Many artists like Leonardo da Vinci studied human anatomy so as to make their painting and culture realistic. Painters found that knowledge of the geometry helped them understand the perspective, and that by noting the changing quality of light, their pictures acquired a three-dimensional quality. Now the question arises, what is meant by perspective? Perspective means that it is a way of depicting the different things on a painting so that we can feel the depth in the painting. This is done by showing the object in front as larger and object behind as a smaller. And here, the use of oil paint as a medium for painting also gave a greater richness of color to paintings than before. Anatomy, geometry, physics, as well as a strong sense of what was beautiful and gave a new quality to the Italian art, which was to be called as realism and which continues till the 19th century. Leonardo da Vinci during the era 1450 to 1519 had an amazing range of interests from botany and anatomy to mathematics and the art. He painted the Mona Lisa and the Last Supper. One of his dreams was to be able to fly. You can see the Mona Lisa picture in this slide also. He spent years observing the birds in the flight and designed a flying machine. He signed his name as Leonardo da Vinci, a discipline of experiment. In the 15th century, city of Rome has grown in a spectacular way. The popes actively encouraged the study of Rome's history. They studied the ruins of old Roman buildings to revive the old Roman style, which used the tall pillars, arches, and domes in buildings. This inspired a new style in the architecture, which was actually a revival of the Imperial Roman style. Now it is called as classical. Popes, wealthy merchants, and aristocrats employed the architects who were familiar with classical architecture. Artists and sculptors were also to decorate the buildings with paints, sculptures, and reliefs. Another remarkable change was that from this time, artists were known individually by name, not as members of a group like earlier. Some individuals were skilled equally as painters, sculptors, and architects. The most expressive is Michelangelo, immortalized by the ceiling he painted for the Pope in the Sistine Chapel, the sculpture called the Dapita, and his design of the Dome of St. Peter's Church, all in Rome. You can see this statue. So left side, it is representing the Pita. This is the statue of the Dapita by Michelangelo, depicts the Mary holding the body of Jesus. And right side, it represents the St. Peter's Square, the church, and the court. In front of it was designed by several artists, including Michelangelo and Bernini. This uses many architectural ideas from ancient Rome. Filippo Brunelleschi. And during the era 1337 to 1446, he is the architect who designed the spectacular Duomo of Florence, had started his career as a sculptor. Italian architecture in the 16th century copied many features of imperial Roman buildings. The printing press, the greatest revolution of 16th century, the mastery of technology is printing. Europeans were indebted to the other people, the Chinese, who first developed the paper and printing with blocks. Earlier, text existed in a few handwritten copies. In 1455, 150 copies of the Bible were printed in the workshop of Johannes Gutenberg, the German who made the first printing press. Earlier, a monk would have taken the same amount of time to write out one copy of the Bible. See the picture of Johannes Gutenberg. By 1500, many classical texts, nearly all in Latin, had been printed in Italy. As printed books became available, students did not have to depend solely on lecture notes. Ideas, opinions, and information moved more widely and more rapidly than ever before. A printed book promoting new ideas could quickly reach hundreds of readers. This also made it possible for individuals to read the books, since it was possible to buy the copies for oneself. This developed the reading habit of among the people. The chief reason that the humanist culture of Italy spread more rapidly in Northern and Western Europe from the end of the 15th century is that printed books were circulating. Then Coming to the new concept of human beings, one of the features of humanist culture was the awakening of the control of the religion over human life. Italians were strongly attracted to material wealth, power, glory, but they were not necessarily religious. They considered the acquisition of power, wealth, and bodily pleasure as desirable and not something to be avoided. Humanism also implied that individuals were capable of shaping their own lives through means other than the mere pursuit of the power and money. This ideal was closely tied with the belief that human nature was many-sided. Niccolo Machiavelli wrote a book on politics, Four Rulers of His Times. He did not try to advise the rulers about the religious ideals of ruling, but how real politics functioned in society. He studied real human beings and their actual political life. Scholars like Machiavelli began a study of human society as they were instead of trying to just say what an ideal society should be like. Since they felt that human beings were motivated by self-interest, they studied self-interest of people and how it could be used. The new idea of individuality and citizenship excluded the women. The men from the aristocratic families dominated public life and were decision makers in their families. They educated their sons to take their places in family business or in public life, at times sending their younger sons to join the church. Although their dowries were invested in the family business, women generally had no say in how their husband should run their business. Often marriages were intended to strengthen the business alliances. If an advocate dowry could not be arranged, daughters were sometimes sent to the convents to live the life of a nun. Obviously, the public role of the woman was limited and they were looked upon the keepers of the households. The position of the woman in the families of merchant was somewhat different. Shopkeepers were often assisted by their wives in running the shop. The families of the merchants and bankers' wives looked after the business when the male members were away on the work. The early death of the merchant compelled his widow to perform a larger public role than was the case in the aristocratic families. So, a few women were intellectually very creative and sensitive about the importance of humanist education. Even though the study of a literature promises and offers no reward for women and no dignity, every woman ought to seek and embrace these studies, wrote the Venetian Cassandra Fedele. She was one of the handful of women who questioned the idea that women were incapable of achieving the qualities of a humanist scholar. Fedele was known for her proficiency in Greek and Latin and was invited to give the orations at the University of Padua. Fedele's writing bring into focus the general regard for education in that age. She was one of the many Venetian women writers who criticized the Republic for creating a highly limited definition of freedom that favored the desires of a man over those of a woman. Another remarkable woman was the Marchesa of Mantua, Isabella di Este, during the year 1474 to 1539. She ruled the state while her husband was absent, and the court of Mantua, a small state, was famed for his intellectual brilliance. Women's writings revealed their conviction that they should have economic power, property, and education to achieve an identity in a world dominated by the men. Debates within the Christianity. The trade and travel, military conquests and diplomatic contacts linked Italian towns and courts with the world beyond. The new culture was admired and imitated by the educated and the wealthy. Very few of the new ideas filtered down to the ordinary man who, after all, could not read or write. The church has dominated the religious and cultural life of people in the medieval times. In this process, it had been become very powerful and rich and also corrupt. Humanist scholars began attacking this and questioning the need for a priesthood and its interpretation of Christianity. In the 15th and early 16th century, many scholars in the university in the North Europe and members of the church too were attracted to humanist ideas. Like their Italian colleagues, they too focused on classical Greek and Rome texts along with the holy books of the Christians. In the northern countries, the humanist members of the church called on Christians to practice the religion in the way laid down in the ancient texts of their religion, discarding unnecessary rituals, which they condemned as later additions to a simple religion. This was a radically new view of human beings as free and rational agents. Later, the philosophers were to return to this over and over again, and inspired by the belief in a distant God who created man, but allowed him complete the freedom to live his life very freely in pursuit of happiness here and now. The Christian humanists like Thomas More in England and Erasmus in Holland felt that church had become an institution marked by greed, extorting money at will from ordinary people. One of the favorite methods of clergy was to sell indulgences, documents which apparently freed the buyer from the burden of the sins he had committed. Christians came to realize from printed translation of the Bible in local languages that their religions did not permit such practices. In the year 1517, a young German monk called Martin Luther, during the era 1483 and 1546, launched a campaign against the Catholic Church and argued that the person did not need the priest to establish a contact with the God. He asked his followers to have a complete faith in God, for the faith alone could guide them to the right life and entry to the heaven. This movement, called the Protestant Reformation, led to the churches in Germany and Switzerland breaking their connection with the Pope and the Catholic Church. In Switzerland, Luther ideas were popularized by Ulrich Zwingli and later by John Calvin. And backed by the merchants, the reformers had greater popular appeal in towns, while in rural areas, the Catholic Church managed to retain its influence. German reformers like Anabaptists were even more radical. They blended the ideas of salvation with the end of the all forms of social oppression. They said that since God created all the people as equal, they were not expected to pay the taxes and they had the right to choose their priest. This appealed to the peasants oppressed by the feudalism. And a major achievement of the reformists was to translate the Bible into popular languages of the people and printing the large quantities and making available to all the people. Earlier, Bible was only in Latin, which ordinary people did not understand. The ideas of Reformation took hold of many people in Germany, Holland, France, and England. In all these countries, people with diverse faith or interpretations of Christianity emerged. Thus, the monopoly of Catholic Church was forever broke. Then, beginning of the modern science. The Middle Ages has accepted the as authority of the knowledge of the past handed down from the generations. Most men were not interested in investigating the world in which they lived. The Roger Bacon was a serious searcher for truth. He performed some experiments with metals and chemicals and probably had a crude microscope. He worked out theories that suggested the practical usefulness of many inventions that have since been made, including steamships and automobiles and airplanes. Long after Roger Bacon, a polished astronomer, Niccolo Copernicus, made the use of the scientific method. He built an observatory from which he patiently studied his heavens. He concluded that old theory of the universe was wrong. In this theory, he taught by the Hellenistic geographer Ptolemy said that Earth is the center of the universe and the stars, sun, and the planets revolve around what were the issues on which the Protestants criticized the Catholic Church. Copernicus claimed that the Earth is one of the number of planets that revolve around the sun. The church rejected the new theory as contrary to the teachings of the Bible and the church. It seemed to rob man of his dignity because he was no longer in the very heart of a universe that had been made for him. And Galileo, an Italian genius, perfected a telescope that made it possible for him to see a ship 50 miles away as clearly as though it were only 5 miles away. He invented a telescope. This instrument also aided in the study of astronomy. Galileo was a very popular and brilliant lecturer and writer. Discussing the theories of Copernicus, he told his audiences how he himself had seen the moons of Jupiter and the revolution of the planet on its axis. For this work, he was summoned to appear before a church court, where he was compelled to take back all his teachings or suffer long imprisonment and probably torture. It is said that as he left the trial, he was heard to mutter, "But the earth does move." Galileo also discovered the certain laws of pendulum, which made it possible to develop more satisfactory clocks. In experiments from the Leaning Tower of Pisa, he proved that heavy and light objects fall at the same time, at the same speed. See, these are the Galileo's invention. During the year 1593, he invented thermometer, and 1597 compass, and 169 telescope, and 1641 he invented pendulum clock. Exploration of sea routes. During the Renaissance, Europeans extended their limited knowledge of geography. There were several reasons for this. The compass and astrolabe, which helped sailors the direction they were going and their location, had been invented. Ships were improved so that they were more seaworthy. And these are the exploration of different sea routes. And students, you observe the map and locate the geographical exploration in the old outline map later. The navigators of Portugal and Spain played an important part in the geographical explorations. Prince Henry, the navigator of Portugal, discovered a sea route to western coast of Africa. Finally, Bartolomeu Dias, a very able Portuguese navigator, sailed around the Cape of Good Hope at the southernmost point of Africa. Vasco da Gama went around Africa and landed in Calicut, India in the year 1498.
India had finally been reached by sailing around the vast African continent. Christopher Columbus determined to find the new route to the east. He believed that the eastern shores of Asia lay across the dark Atlantic, and so he set out with three small ships to get there. After a long and dangerous voyage, Columbus reached the land on an island on October 12th during the year 1492. He thought he had reached the East Indies and called the natives Indians. He confirmed that the New World discovered, which is nothing but America by Columbus, was quite different from Asia. And Ferdinand Magellan, a sailor of Spain, made the voyage route and world with the help of a Spanish king, Charles I. He crossed the Atlantic and went around the southern tip of the South America and sailing through the straits. He reached the Pacific Ocean and landed at the islands of Philippines. This voyage was a great landmark in the history of exploration of the sea routes. Let us now consider the concept of Renaissance. Can we see this period as marking a sharp break with the past and the rebirth of ideas from the Greek and Roman traditions? Was the earlier period, 12th and 13th centuries, a time of darkness? So, recent writers like Peter Berghoff of England have suggested that Burkhard was exaggerating the sharp differences between this period and the one that preceded it by using the term Renaissance, which implies that Greek and Roman civilizations were reborn at this time and that scholars and artists of this period substituted and the pre-Christian world and view for the Christian one. Both arguments were exaggerated. Scholars in earlier centuries had been familiar with Greek and Roman cultures, and religions continued to be a very important part of people's lives. To contrast the Renaissance as a period of dynamism and artistic creativity and the Middle Age as a period of gloom and lack of development is an oversimplification. Many elements associated with the Renaissance in Italy can be traced back to the 12th and 13th centuries. It has been suggested by some historians that in the 9th century in France, there had been similar literary and artistic blossoming. The cultural changes in Europe at this time were not shaped just by the classical civilization of Rome and Greece. The archaeology and the literary recovery of Roman culture did create a great admiration of that civilization. But technologies and skills in Asia had moved far ahead of what the Greeks and Romans had known. Much more of the world had become connected, and the new techniques of navigation enabled the people to sail much further than had been possible earlier. The expansion of Islam and the Mongol conquest had linked the Asia and North America, Africa with Europe, not politically, but in terms of trade and learning skills. The Europeans learned not just from the Greeks and Romans, but from India, Arabia, Iran, Central Asia, and China. These debates were not acknowledged for a long time because the history of this period started to be written, historians saw it from a Europe-centered viewpoint. European Renaissance in the 14th century. An important change that did happen in this period was gradually the private and the public spheres of life began to become separate. Then public sphere meant that area of the government and of formal religion, whereas private sphere included the family and personal religion. The individual had a private as well as a public role. He was not a simply member of one of these three orders. He was also a person in his own right. In the 18th century, the sense of the individual would be expressed in a political form in the benefit of all individuals had equal political rights. I repeat, all individuals had equal political rights. Another development was that different religions of Europe started to have their separate sense of identity based on language. Europe, earlier united partly by the Roman Empire and later by the Latin and Christianity, was now dissolving into nation states, each united by a common language. So, dear students, these three questions, take these three questions as assignment and write at home. First question is, how did the printing of the Bible influence the ideas about God and church? And next one is, which elements of Greek and Roman culture were received and in the 14th and 15th centuries? And the last question is, why were Italian towns the first to experience the ideas of humanism? These are the three are the important questions we can expect in the end examinations. And dear students, I hope you have understood this lesson very well. Thank you all.